Welcome to this Calendly tutorial. In this video, I'm going to explain to you how to create a one-on-one event. On your homepage, just below, you will notice a button named New Event Type. When you click it, it takes you to the next page, which shows a heading, Create New Event Type. You will find that there is a one-on-one event, group event, collective event, and a round-robin event. So today, we're going to focus on the one-on-one event. We use this type of event when we want to meet with just one invitee. So for us to proceed, we click on the button Create, which is adjusted to one-on-one event. We will be presented with a section which says, what event is this? Let's say we want to make a 30-minute meeting with an invitee. After naming the event, we go to the location section. Under this section, it gives you multiple options. You can have an in-person meeting where you can meet with the person physically. You can call them. You can meet them on Google Meet, Zoom, Microsoft Teams, GoToMeeting, Custom, or you can actually ask the invitee to set the location for you. Let's just say we want to use a phone call. I will call my invitee. If I choose this option, what happens is that I can extract the invitee's phone number and call them later. Under this other section, then my invitee should call me. I will provide a number that the invitee can use. Just for this example, we are going to use, I will call my invitee, and we click Update. This description or instructions section comes next. Here, we can put instructions for the invitee. Just as an example, let's just say, please leave your details in the coming form. So, after that, we go to the event link. Now, it's very important that we fill this section in, especially when we want to use our links in the website. It's easier to identify them if we name them after the event name. So let's just say 30. Rather, we can actually copy from the event name. And we paste. Event color actually allows you to differentiate the tabs. So we'll just choose just a nice color like orange. After doing this whole section, we click Next. It will take you to the next part, which is when can people book this event? So the first section is the event duration. So it tells the client how long the meeting will be. So let's just say 30 minutes because it's going to be a 30-minute meeting. It's also important that we identify the date range. Under this example, we are noticing that there's a default setting of 60 days. But sometimes it might happen that people forget that they've put an appointment in 60 days. So for me, I'm just going to choose 30 days. So you can actually choose it over a period of rolling days, over a date range. It will get you a possible date range that you can actually choose from, or you can just put an indefinite period. Right now, we're going to use over a period of rolling days. Calendar days, you can actually choose business days, Monday to Friday, or just calendar days. I usually use the calendar days. Apply. The next section is the event time zone. So for us to make a customization, we have to click Edit. So there are two types of time zone styles. There's a local time zone style and a locked time zone style. So if we use a local time zone style, what this means is that the invitees will see your availability in their time zone. So we usually use this for virtual meetings. However, there's this second type of time zone style where you have to lock to a specific time zone. Usually this is more recommended in a in-person meeting. So you can actually choose from a list of time zones depending on which part of the world you live in. So for now, we're going to use the local time zone. Now, on setting our availability, that is very important because this is when you schedule the hours when the people can schedule a meeting with you. Now, this shows us a piece of your calendar. So if we want to change, let's say, all Mondays, the times for all Mondays, we simply click. Let's say we want to start at 8 o'clock on Monday. So we put an 8 there up to probably 3 o'clock, let's say 1500. So there are two options there. You can apply this setting only on the 9th of November, which is today, which is the current Monday. Or you can actually apply this to all Mondays. So it's actually usually practical to apply it to all the Mondays. Once you do that, all the Mondays, the scheduling time would be from 8:50 to 1500. As you can see, the changes have occurred there. Another important part is the advanced section. Now, if you go to the advanced section, it gives you several options that you can actually use that we're going to talk about. For example, we have availability increments. So on your page, you can have increments of 5 minutes or increments of 10 minutes. Just as an example, on your page, when you click the date and it takes you to the time for scheduling, it will increase by 30-minute slots. If you say 5 minutes, it will increase by 5-minute slots. So for us, we leave 30-minute slots. The maximum events per day. You can actually limit the number of events you can have per day. For me, I'm going to limit them to 5. Minimum scheduling notice. It's very important to set this part up because what happens is that a person might actually set up a meeting 5 minutes before and it's difficult for you to actually prepare for that meeting. So let's say probably 6 hours before a person can set up a meeting, which gives me 6 hours for me to prepare for that meeting. Event buffers are also a very important part of setting up events. Why? You can actually put gaps between your meetings. For example, you can put a buffer before an event, let's say 5 minutes, let's say 10 minutes before an event and 10 minutes after an event. This gives you time to prepare for the next meeting. Let's say you have a client for 30 minutes and you go over that time by 5 minutes, which means that buffer will actually give you more time to go for the next meeting. And obviously, your client or your invitee won't be that angry because you have given yourself enough time to go to the next event. So for me, I would just put 10 minutes after an event. Well, this option simply can hide your event from the main Calendly page. For now, we want that event to actually appear. So we're going to go to the next section. Now, if you notice, we have done this first section. Now, on different events, this is the main section that's actually different. We're going to deal with the additional options under a different tutorial video. So for today, we've seen how we can set up one-on-one events, and you can actually visit my YouTube page and find out how we can set up additional options of an event.